Okay.
She'll share with me.
Perfect.
You have a favorite.
There you go. So, as you're aware, we're going to be talking about budgets. But before we jump directly into the budget side, I really want to take a couple steps back before we get to that point. So, if I were to ask you how well you feel, or how well you know or understand personal finance, how would you grade yourself?
How well I know, what did you say?
How well do you understand personal finance? How would you grade yourself?
1 to 10, A.
An A? High five for those that say A. Over half of Americans grade themselves C, D, or F. And one of the awesome parts about you all being here, you're already engaged with the subject matter. So that plays very well. Eight pillars, which is a tool that I'm giving to you, is one of those tools that you're going to be able to access right now and in the future. So that small sheet actually allows you to log into Eight Pillars University. It gives you the ability to create, set up your own account, and track your personal finances from this point forward indefinitely. So through the organization I work, MCUCD, we are offering this to you at no charge, which is really awesome. There is a workbook that you're going to be able to access. There's a book, there's worksheets, and I'll show you a lot more of the web here in a little bit. But it's a super cool tool. So today we're going to talk about financial greatness. And financial greatness is more than just upward prosperity. Did you know that 70% of Americans live paycheck to paycheck? And that does not mean the, and it's not determining on how much they make. So an individual making $20,000 a year, 70% of those living paycheck to paycheck. Millionaires, same stats. So again, this tool hopefully will provide you some assistance to really give you some baseline and some momentum. One of the big parts of Eight Pillars University is often to talk about doers and those individuals that are actually doers. The cool part, you're here already, so I know you're a doer, right? So again, taking steps back, and this is what we're talking about right now, value. What do you value? Health, family,
time,
absolutely. Other things?
Stability.
Ability?
Stability.
Stability.
Security.
Security. So it's easy to give you five, right? And you probably all have these pretty close to your top five. If I asked for your number 20th value, what do you think you're going to be saying?
DVD.
DVDs. Perfect. That one was easy. Right? What she said. DVDs, everybody. We're in the midst of winter here in Montana. Heat's important, right? So here's my question to you about values. If I ask for your top five values, and someone in your household that you share finances with was asked for their top five values, would it be the same? It better be, right? It better be. But the reality is, it doesn't work that way. And if you were to get a list of 20 values, and on your 16th, you say, I love going out to dinner. And that person says, I love to golf. You're not sitting on the same value at the same time. So sharing that list and creating that list individually really helps you approach that financial situation with open eyes. And that's the importance of looking at those values. One of the big parts of Eight Pillars University, if you go online, if you access your account, a lot of times in the program, they'll talk about those that are doers, as I've mentioned. This is one of those projects. We would want you to put together your value list, because your value list is going to be the basis of how you proceed forward when you're budgeting. So, what knowledge and behaviors separate those people who reach financial greatness and those who do not? So what you'll see is, laser pointer, that's fun, right? Financial meagerness. What do you think that means?
Paycheck to paycheck.
Paycheck to paycheck. Non-risk taker.
Bad luck.
Bad luck, absolutely.
Bad decisions.
Bad decisions.
Lack of education.
Thank you, lack of education. Because what you don't know, right? So, hopefully, throughout today, which I've learned a lot, and throughout going out to Eight Pillars, looking at the other online resources, that you're acquiring that knowledge and that tool of saying, I'm learning something on this one, or I don't get it. I need to ask someone who does get it. So I'm going to briefly go over the different Eight Pillars, because as I said, that small sheet of paper is giving you access to 100% of the Eight Pillars. So, pillar one, and we will talk about pillar one today. So this is going to be establishing your financial confidence account. And financial confidence, which surprisingly enough, a lot of people have been referring to something in this line today. I'm gonna provide a name to it. So I'll jump into more detail, but pillar one, financial confidence account. Financial confidence account is going to be that savings for the what ifs. What if something happens? What are you gonna do? So we're gonna talk about establishing that financial confidence. Pillar two, organize and systemize for success. Automate, that's huge. So I myself am currently going through Eight Pillars. I am not 100% perfect on any one of the pillars, except number five. They say I'm really good, and we'll get to that one. But I just did this. It is so empowering when you automate your finances, because I guarantee that rent or that home loan is the same time every month, right? Car payments, shocking enough, the same time every month. So the basis of this program was all built on research. And what research showed, people that were financial great, in financial greatness, and those that were in meagerness, how they really set themselves apart and how they got to that level. And the reality was, huge part of it was automation. Some of you may not be at all comfortable with some automation, but I would say it's something to visit because it will relieve that stress. So again, I'll jump more into detail on this pillar as well. Calculating your net worth. Any of you know your net worth right now?
What do you mean by net worth? Do you mean net cash flow in per year or net bucks in the account right now?
The account right now, it's going to be looking at your assets and liabilities.
Okay.
So what is your net worth at this very moment?
51 cents.
Well, at least it's in the positive. Let's go with that one. Breaking your financial barriers and bonds. A lot of conversation is had on this one, and this one's heavy. This one's a heavy one. I'll show you a video in this one. It may be quite depressing for some of you, but I'll show you a video. What is the number one barrier? And we talked about this. That sets you apart from breaking your financial bonds and barriers. And if you get it right, I'll give you a workbook.
Fear.
What?
Fear.
So, I'm giving you this. There you go, education. The knowledge, right? We talked knowledge. Can I click up here? Absolutely. Lack of knowledge, right? So as you're learning, as you're going through, you're going to be able to go, huh, I got this one. I want to learn more on this. And that will give you the ability to hyper-focus, come back out, concentrate on something else. Getting rid of consumer debt and improving your credit score. Sometimes credit score can feel like it's a dartboard, right? So if you aim right, you'll get the right number. So they'll demystify that whole credit score. Pillar four, taking care of what ifs. What if you leave today and you get into a horrendous car accident? Do you have something planned? Your child gets severely ill. What if? So this will talk about that. It's really built on the other side of the financial confidence account that you can fall back. And the reality is the burden should be the emotions. The burden shouldn't be the financial. So insurance, estate planning. Pillar five, invest for happiness now and in the future. So it's really going to look at that long term. So establishing the front end, then looking at the long term. And this pillar is the one that everybody wants to get to. And the reality is, we need to take some steps before we get to this one. So become a saver, research opportunities, take actions, set the five mousetraps for investing. The reality is investing, you can do it. And it shows that you as women can do it very well. So going through that. Pillar six, make your home the heart of the matter. Money matters. Really, really cool on this one, and really, really sharp on this one. If it doesn't meet, meaning your mortgage payment, your home payment, doesn't meet your budget, it'll be the first one to say, see you later, find a new home that does. And that's tough. That can be really tough. But the reality is, we talked about values, right? If your number one value was to look cool in front of people, or to have the coolest house on the block, then you're already investing in that, right? But if that wasn't one of the top priorities, so this one's great because it talks about the real number. It's also one of those, as someone who purchased a home, and purchased a home recently, I knew what my budget number was. Even though the mortgage loan officer said, go for the sky, you can make it to this point. And the reality is, I had to self-check and say, no, this is my budget. And I fell in love with a home. I didn't buy that home. I didn't buy it because it didn't fit my budget. So this one's great because it will talk about when you have a number in mind, you're working with a realtor that's going to be helping you. You're going to be working with a mortgage loan officer. And in the process, this isn't going to make you the expert. It's going to be able to ask the questions of the experts that they're giving you answers that you believe, you trust, and you proceed forward. So the Coolio part, the real Coolio part, is they always say, find the heart of an educator. So when you're working with someone and that person has the heart of an educator, you're learning something. And you're learning something that's going to be invaluable now and in the future and your friends and so on and so forth. So I touched on this. Pillar seven, maximize your money-making machine. Okay, for another workbook, what's your money-making machine? Who said you? Perfect. That's exactly what it is. So investing in yourself, and this has been a conversation that most of today has been about, investing in you so that you maximize what you do to the best of its ability. right? This one's pretty cool because you kind of feel all warm and good about yourself when you're done, because you truly know this is what I need to do and these are the steps to do it in a way that is going to make the most impact on me long term. Pillar 8, get perspective by giving back. So, am I asking for a handout here?
No.
Not at all. What am I asking for? Pay it forward, contribution. So, question for you. If you're a millionaire and you give $500,000 to, let's say, U of M, and you have that to give, feel pretty good about yourself, right? Well, I'm making an impact. I'm giving back to the school, right? So, you're of a different means. You're driving through Starbucks. You realize, you know what? The person behind me needs a coffee on me today. I'm paying it behind me, but I'm paying it forward, right? So, is the feeling for the donor who gave or the feeling for the person at Starbucks any different?
No.
Not at all. So, it's really looking at that perspective and saying, you know what? What can I do to give back? And if it's giving back in time, that's just as important, because you know what? Time's invaluable. I could pull out a five and I could give it to someone. That one's easy. Barely takes any time, call it a day, let's move on. But when you take time, that's a huge give. So it's really looking at that and giving back, because you know what? Feels good here. So super cool tool. So let's jump in. Sound good? And I apologize, I have a head cold like no other. I feel like I'm talking right here. So, I gave you that small sheet. That's to 8 Pillars University. This is what it's going to look like. Sign up, and then you'll log in. Sign up, super easy, and we're providing it to you for free, which is really great. So, this is what you have in front of you. Once you log in, this is what you're gonna see. Awesome, awesome, awesome part, the report card. The report card will give you a baseline of those things that you should really concentrate in. So, like I said, pillar 5, I've got it. I'm already investing. I'm putting money away. I can back off from that. I needed to establish my financial confidence account, so I'm working on that one. So here it will give you the idea. Here's additional resources. This one, for those of you that are tech savvy, and I saw most of you raise your hand, I sat in the back when the question was, who's got a smartphone? And I saw a lot of hands go up. Tablets, lots of hands, computer, and then the question of who doesn't have any technology? And I didn't see any hands. So, it's a free tool. And even if it's a tool that you go out to print off the super budget worksheet, which is super geek for awesome Excel file. It's right there. Yeah. And those that do, that's the rock star part. Like when I see that, I'm like, oh, groovy. And it's smart. So it won't let you screw up. It will auto-calculate smartly. The automated money organizer, that is the gives you the ability to take all of your accounts. So you can take your bank account, your investment account. You can take your retirement accounts. You can take your car loans. You can take your bills and apply all of that information within this one tool, and it gives you the ability to look at your assets, bill pays that are going out. It gives you an overall look, right? Because everything has a different login. This is bank level secure, and it's read only. So if you're worried that someone's going to go in and grab your file to take money out of your checking account and give it to themselves, they cannot do it. Because it is read only, you're giving them access to grab a number, not access to move. So you're not paying bills here. Clear as mud?
Is it analogous to the worksheet?
So the worksheet is going to be built more on the super budget side.
Okay.
But there's components absolutely within there that you'll apply to that budget worksheet.
But you have a choice who gets access.
Absolutely. Absolutely. So I throw this one up. So this gives you the view of that report card. And what you can see, and for those of you in the back, because again, I was sitting in the back, this one's hard. This says basic, this says advanced. So when you take the first checklist, it'll give you the basic. And as you improve, you can go advanced, and it's going to expand to another level to give you more items to work on to create that, to finish up that pillar. So this one's great, because like I said, number 5 looked really good until I hit advanced. So let's talk about establishing a financial confidence account. It's a completely liquid and separate account. So this is the ability for you to create an account and set aside, hopefully aside, so that it's not accessed easily. So you love that new pair of brown boots down at Dillard's here at the mall. You're like, I'm taking money out and I'm getting a new pair of shoes. No, this is going to be set aside. Online banking is a great option for this one because it gives you the ability to go, do I really need it? Do I really want it? Right? And so if it takes you a little bit more to get that money, more than likely you're going to talk yourself out of that account. So establishing a financial confidence account is really important. And I'm not asking for all of it to be done tomorrow. Building that account is important. Putting a little away. So, no touch, separate account. One of the requests within 8 pillars is to make 15% of it in cash. And so, putting that away in a fire safe, water safe is important. You can buy one for around $40 on Amazon. You can get it in pink. We got them for our office. No, they were worried that I wouldn't want a pink one. And I'm like, whatever, bring it on. Who doesn't want it? You'll see it. So at least 15% in cash. So does this make sense? This last comment? Right? Absolutely. I backed into a tree. It's going to be okay. The tree moved. Dang nabbit. I hate when that happens. Yeah, when that emergency happens, you're not concerned about the dollars, you're concerned about the people. Right? You can fix things. You can't. Yeah. So, why do you think that's the most important? Absolutely. Well, and by establishing this account, you're creating the ability to really fall back and view on what is important, going back to your values, right? To say, my family's my number one important value. I'm not worrying about the little hiccups. So, not too shabby. All right, so number 2, organize and systemize your account. Net worth. What was net worth? Sorry? Yep. So, go ahead. Minus liabilities. Assets minus liabilities. So, if I had to ask what your financial plan is, what your budget looks like, which one would you say? You don't have to tell me. But the reality is, we want the paradigm to go from here, the blue dot, to the blueprint, right? So as it acquires more and more detail, you're going to be able to see a much better vivid picture of what's going on. So here, there's sometimes a scary face to this one. You know, I see that, there's a bird. Exactly. And this one, you understand what it looks like. If you gave it to someone who actually builds home, they'd probably laugh first. But secondarily, they'd say, oh, I see a door and I'm gonna have to add 3 windows to the front of the house. But we don't have any dimensions to it. And in this one, you have the exact outline of what is needed. So that's the hope of Pillar 2, is to walk you through that paradigm of, I need to go from here, if this is where you're at, to here. And if you're already here, good to go, let's move on. So I'm a super tech geek. I'm all about the gadgets. So to me, this is like downloading a map on your smartphone. And the reality is, the moment you open up that map, it's pulling in the wireless, it's pulling on the cell towers, it's pulling in the relationship to the other phones in the room, so on and so forth. So the super geek side is, it's taking all of this information in and giving you an exact point that you are here. And that's really what this pillar does, is it's going to create a you are here and allows you then to go, what is my next steps? Is it Fidelity that has the commercial with the green dot that starts and then moves, right? Same type of concept. You are here, let's move you forward. So net worth, add up your assets, minus your liabilities, subtract your liabilities from assets. What does this do? Gives you a foundation. What else?
Net worth.
It gives you the net worth, absolutely.
It makes your double entry bookkeeping accountant
happy. It makes your accountant happy. It gives you the truth. It shows you what you need to do. And when you see the truth, what does the truth do? What? It depends. But so the story goes, at one of these openings, presentations, they were talking about the net worth. Someone in the way back goes, it gives you the truth. And someone in the front goes, which will set you free. And then it was like, ugh. But it really does. So, I know in one of the breakouts they were talking about Gene Chatsky that said, take a folder or a little ring binder with you everywhere you go and write down everything you buy all day long, right? If you have an account that you access online, I'm sure your account, if you use your debit card quite a bit, if you're the person that goes to the ATM, pulls out cash, and buys things, I'm pretty certain that you will probably know where that money goes. But track your funds. So to go back to that doer at the front end, I challenge you to do it within a month. I challenge you to track every single dollar for the next month. And the reason is, if you haven't already done so, it's going to help you build that budget. And most of you, maybe some of you, I would have been the person going, just tell me what it is and let me move on so I can get the job done, right? That's really what you would like, is just give me the tool, let's call it a day and let's just be done with it so I can move forward. Well, I can't. I don't know your personal finances. You do. You know how you spend your money, and that's the importance of you tracking it. So, any new news to you in regards to fixed and variable? Okay, give me an example of fixed. Mortgage.
Utilities.
Yep, good. How about a variable?
Taxes.
Taxes what? Groceries.
Eating out.
You had, yeah, the furnace broken. You clearly have a great grasp on those two concepts. Unplanned expenses. Backing into a tree, healthcare. So why would this be up there and in a different color? You can't plan for it, you can be prepared, and we want to be prepared with what? The confidence account, right? If we put too much weight in that unplanned, you're going to be saving for a lot of chaos. So, here's the important part. Again, on the side of those tables, and if you need more, I printed a lot. So, if you need more of the budget worksheet, they're up on the corners, and I welcome you to grab more if that's what you need. But if you're the person that needs to write it down, go for it. My friends in the Excel land, if that's what you want to do, online banking, if that's where you live, my credit union that I'm a member of, it actually provides me with a pie chart of my spending. It's pretty cool. Save receipts. Do what works best for you. I am not here to tell you you have to go online. I'd like you to go on to 8 Pillars, but you don't have to. But the reality is you need to do what's best for you. And if it's a matter of paper and pencil and going that route, rock on. A couple coolio things that I've learned. If you track your expenses and your income per week, it really gives you a great view of the cash flow throughout the month. Because most of the time, we talk about budgets in a month perspective, right? So just track it for a month. But if you track it and really look at that week, when I was working with high school students and some of them were living on their own, I would tell them, I want you to track your income and your expenses per week, so that we can see the cash flow, because if all of your bills are on the 20th and you're getting paid on the 10th, you're not planning on the 20th, even though the 20th shows up the same 10 days after the 10th you're paid. So that was helpful, and that's helpful to even get a perspective of how that flows. So probably no big surprise, but all of those things that are fun will probably shock you in regards to the amount that you spend per year. I love to ski, right? And so in working and prioritizing and providing a value to me getting out and going ski has a budget expense in the winter. But in the summer, I'm not gonna have a skiing budget. And if I did, that'd be weird. Unless I'm going to South America, right? So, let's talk about the B word. So, again, going back to values, commit it to paper. If you're working on a budget and you're trying to make it effective and you're not working your values into it and you're putting money into things that aren't important, either that needs to become a value or you need to quit spending money on it, right? Is this foreign? So I talked about the automated money organizer to assist you in that one. Pillar 3. And I told you about pillar 3, right? This is going to be the heavy one, right? So what's keeping you from? Right? What's your debt keeping you from? What is the one thing that you're not able to do? Do you like going on vacation? Do you want to go on vacation? Is that something? So in this pillar, they talk about 4 debts that are okay. And they really want you to work on bringing down that debt and paying that debt off. The 4 okay debts. Any ideas? Home. What? Education, student loans.
Car.
Car.
Insurance.
Insurance six, right? Pillar six. Work, if you need to take a business loan. So if you need a loan to do your job. So those are the ones that if you have, you put those at the bottom of trying to alleviate, take away that debt. The other debt raises to the top. And we want some really good wins, right? So if you have an unsecured loan that's a small amount that you want to really work hard at taking away, then go for it. So debt can be really heavy, right? So again, I keep on going back to values, but we've talked about values. So this is the video.
I just can't get these numbers to add up.
It's like we're never gonna get out of this hole.
Credit card debt, does it ever end?
Maybe I can help. We sure could use it.
We've tried debt consolidation companies.
We've even taken out loans to help make payments.
Well, you're not the only ones. Did you know millions of Americans live with debt they cannot control? That's why I developed this unique new program for managing your debt. It's called Don't Buy Stuff You Cannot Afford.
Should not buy anything. Sounds interesting.
Sounds confusing.
I don't know, honey. This makes a lot of sense. There's a whole section here on how to buy expensive things using money you save.
Give me that. And where would you get this saved money?
I tell you where and how in chapter 3.
Okay, but what if I want something but I don't have any money?
You don't buy it.
Well, let's say I don't have enough money to buy something. Should I buy it anyway?
No.
Now I'm really confused.
It's a little confusing at first.
Well, what if you have the money? Can you buy something?
Yes.
Now take the money away. Same story?
Nope. You shouldn't buy stuff when you don't have the money.
I think I got it. I buy something I want and then hope that I can pay for it, right?
No. You make sure you have money, then you buy it.
Oh, then you buy it. But shouldn't you buy it before you have the money?
No.
Why not?
It's in the book. It's only one page long. The advice is priceless and the book is free.
Wow, I like the sound of that.
Yeah, we can put it on our credit card.
So get out of debt now. Write for your free copy of Don't Buy Stuff You Cannot Afford. And if you order now, you'll also receive Seriously, if you don't have the money, don't buy it. Along with a 12-month subscription to Stop Buying Stuff magazine. So order today.
It seems like a simple concept, right? Very simple. So, one simple rule. If you cannot pay your credit cards off in full every month, you need to cut them up. It's tough. It's really tough. The reason why this is provided within eight pillars is really to set that boundary so that you know yourself and you know how to handle that financial burden. It gets tough, and it can get real tough. And with that, it's very sharp, and it's very visual. But the burden long-term will be beneficial. So, you know who this guy is, right? Do you know what he said? What's the most powerful force in the universe? Compound interest. Brilliant, right? Brilliant. And why did he say that? Because it's true. My hope to you is that interest is working for you, not against you, right? And that credit card statement, that is, if you can't pay it off in full, cut it up. I want interest working for you, not against you. And if you're not able to pay off the credit cards, it's working against you. So keeping that knowledge and knowing that you want to break that barrier is important. And it's important because, one, if you establish those core values and you're working towards those core values and setting your budget based on those, it's making that difference so that long term you're going after those goals and you're accomplishing those things that are important to you and the people in their lives. One of the great parts of even going back to the budgeting is bringing in those kids in your world, those grandkids in your world, because those are the people you love, right? And there's probably a budget allocated to even those grandkids. And when the time comes, grandma and grandpa, grandma has X number of dollars. What are we going to do with this money? How are we going to spend it? And that's a really strong teachable moment, because it allows them to go, here are my priorities, here are my values, where's grandma's or grandpa's, grandma and grandpa's, and let's talk about the budget. And I never had that conversation. I don't know if any of you have had that conversation with a grandparent, but that's pretty powerful. And the trials and tribulations of don't do the credit card thing, it can get tough. There are great moments that you can teach others as well to say, hey, this isn't working great. One of my coworkers, she'll say, most people will give sex advice more than they'll ever give financial advice. So what does that say you're an expert in? And the reality is, there's some really cool teachable moments you can have with a lot of people around you. One of the conversations we had when I was up over here in the corner, it was just saying, go to your financial institution and ask the person that you trust and say, I don't understand this. I'm trying to set up a budget. I'm really failing here. Is there someone here that can help me? And I know at the credit union for sure, someone will. And I promise you they'll sit down, they'll talk you through and work with you in establishing that budget. So it's being able to say, uncle, right? One of the presenters said, you as females are way okay with asking for directions. Just that. So I, done with my presentation, if there's specific questions you have, happy to answer.
Loans on a home, loans on a car, loans on education. Are those the same categories as credit card debt?
Loans on the home, loans on the car, loans on
education.
Are they the same as credit card debt?
No.
They are not considered, not within the eight pillars realm, the same type of debt. Answer your question?
When is it okay to acquire those things, those particular kinds of debt?
When is it okay to acquire those type of debts? I am not a financial advisor. I will state that. I think it's looking at your budget, and it's looking at your income and your assets, and understanding what is the ultimate goal. So you want to look at long-term goals and short-term goals. And if a short-term goal is to say, I need a car so I can get to work, I think you need to factor that in and understand where your budget number is for that vehicle. Talking about values, let's talk about cars. So I really like Audis. I love Audis. But my budget doesn't allow an Audi, right? Maybe an 87, but not a brand new Audi. That is not my budget. So it's looking at those items that are important to say, Do I want to homeown or do I want to rent? And if I homeown, what is my limit? Where can I go with that? It's then going to a vehicle and saying, I need reliable transportation from point A to point B so that I can go to work and I can get to work without having to call and say, golly gee willikers, I'm really sorry, but the car's down again, right? And so making sure you have something reliable. Education debt. Education debt is huge, and I could go on for hours of rants on that. My past was in education, specifically paying for school. So I could talk, like I said, for hours, and that's a whole nother subject. But the reality is, I need you to look at what you want to be and what debt you're taking. And if what you want to be and your debt cannot be paid based off that income once you have that career, then you need to make sure that the debt that you're acquiring can be paid by that career.
Okay.
Make sense? And most do not budget. And I know traditional students, and I was traditional, I just thought, oh, I'll just take this loan, this will be awesome. And I went to a private school. And I'm still going to that private school. Answer your question?
Yeah, you say this program is free. Everything has a cost factor. Is there somebody monitoring it, the statistician or something? There's usually a cost factor.
There is, typically. Yeah, absolutely. So the cost is free. I'm not. No one at my office is monitoring specifically the Eight Pillars program because MCUCD, Montana Credit Unions for Community Development, is a nonprofit organization. We purchased the rights to Eight Pillars University, and because of that purchase of the rights, we give it out for free to the individuals that ask us to come in and help out. So it's 100% free, and there's no getcha. I promise you. I swear to God, because I was always the guy that's like, what's the getcha moment here? I promise you, there is no getcha. It's 100% free.
It's not just the first month.
It's not even just the first month.
So this obviously paid off my private college loan.
High five, that's huge. I got a couple years left.
I'm wondering, when you're calculating your net worth, is what I paid off, now I own that, is that part of my net worth calculation, or is that
not? So the question is, would you calculate the debt you pay off on your education as part of your net worth? We're not looking specifically on net worth being the items that you have value in regards to my education is worth this. An asset's going to be something that you can sell, right? I don't want you to sell your education. Answer your question. Awesome. So the question is, how do you calculate how much you should have in your financial confidence account? They get into a lot more detail. So when I was talking about today, I was really kind of snorkeling and not scuba diving. To scuba dive here for a second, $1,000 is really where they want you to work, but the reality is, I don't think it should be there tomorrow. So you gotta work on it and put 20 away, and at some point, put 150 away in cash, right? So that you have that set aside. Then from that point, you then continue to save until you have 3 months, at least 3 months of wages set aside. Now, average, an industry talks typically about 6 months. So once you have the 3 months, then continue saving or putting it into less of a liquid, like a IRA. But the reality is, again, taking those steps to get to that point. Super cool person that I met 2 weeks ago, she actually paid her bills in advance. So when she opens up her bills, she has a zero balance. How cool is that? Like, how, like, then you'd totally be like, look at the Verizon bill, it's zero. Rather than, here's a $3,000 Verizon bill and we only have three phones on it, right? So she took it to the step that she would pay, and it would take maybe 4 months to get there, but that's how she got to that point. Here, and then I'll run over here, okay?
Do you have any wisdom to share about reverse mortgages?
Reverse mortgages, I do not. One of the great parts on the online portion, it has a reference side, and it allows you to look up and give a call to those people that are not going to be proprietary in regards to going, I need you to do this and this and send me your social security number. So they do have a resource to give you that information. I do not know of someone offhand either. Missoula Aging Services. Perfect. That's awesome. Thank you.
What do you do when you don't have that set? Let's say you're in Ontario, you don't have any set paycheck every 2 weeks. How do you plan budget for that? Because obviously you can't like take your income and then subtract all your $5,000.
Yeah. So as a private entrepreneur, how I would calculate that out of setting aside your financial confidence account. The State Labor and Industry Board gives you statistics in regards to what your income wage would be in that particular job. And because of that, then I'd calculate that number out based on that industry standard specific to, I know they'll even drill down to Missoula. So that's how I'd calculate. Answer your question?
Yeah.
Or,
I don't know if you deal with this, but years ago, when I was buying a home, I had a contract where I could pay off all the principal every month with no penalty. And I was able to reduce a 15-year down to a 5-year, a 10-year down to a 4-year. Are they still available like that?
Yes.
I do not know that.
They do. They do have some. One of the pillars in here specifically talks about home mortgages, and the number one is, the conversation is get fixed. That's important. And then looking at what point do you talk about refinancing, and how do you get to that path? But you're specifically talking paying down on the principal side.
I made double payments on my principal.
Okay.
Every month. And then you brought it down. 15 years, you're down 5, then you're down 4. Just pay.
So yeah, one of the things you want to be really, really careful of in that type of scenario is the other common thing that's relatively new is making mortgage payments every 2 weeks.
Yep.
And paying half your mortgage every 2 weeks. And the theory being that you get that thing in there 2 weeks early, you save 2 weeks of interest, and over the course of the loan, it becomes a substantial amount of money. Be really careful on the language on it, because some of them, they're just taking it in 250% part increments, but you're not getting the benefit of giving it to them 15 days early. Make sure you get the benefit for doing that.
And no penalty.
That's right. That's right.
Like, how much do you manage debt to start paying down aside from your mortgage or student loans? Would you recommend tackling the one with the highest interest rate or the highest balance?
That's a great question. So the question was, should you tackle the ones with the highest interest rate or the highest amount?
So
here's what I would say to that one. I want you to have some good wins short term. So if there's something that you can get rid of quickly, absolutely. Let's jump in that, because that feels good here really fast, and then tackle those long term. But if those long terms are daunting and you know that you need to get on that, I would say move those to the top. So it's not a one, like, I wouldn't say it's a quick fix for everyone. This is the way to do it. But if you need a short term win for here and here, then go that route first. But if you know that long term you need to tackle it, then go for it. I know I'm not answering it the way you want me to. Right?
I don't know if that's on or not,
here.
But the one thing that I'd like for you to think about is if you Google PowerPay,
If you do that, then you have the opportunity to enter in some of the debts that you have, and you can actually see how much you would save by paying off this one versus that one, and then you can decide, is that incentive worth it or not? Mm-hmm. But PowerPay was developed by Utah State University. It is a wonderful program. It used to be available on a CD, but now it's available on the web. So anybody can go in there and experiment with that, and it's a great educational
awesome.
Tool.
PowerPay? PowerPay.org.com.
Just Google PowerPay.
Just Google PowerPay. All right, so I have 2 minutes left. And then you guys are going to get to do some Zumba.
Yeehaw.
Tough question for you.
Okay.
I
So you're asking how to balance your budget.
Yeah.
Balance so you have the ability to save.
Okay.
Right? I mean, is that the jux of what you're at? I have money coming in, I have money going out, and at the end, I want some money to be saved.
Yes.
Right? For the financial confidence. So looking at tracking your budget for that month.
Okay.
And prioritizing, here's what's important to me. I like to go out to eat. It's important to go out to eat. But do I go from eating out 2 times a month to 1 time a month? Let's try it again. 2 times a week to 1 time a week. And taking those funds and start funneling those. Right? Because as that confidence account grows,
then there's a buffer for in case something happens.
Absolutely. Okay. So looking at that itemized, this is what I spend day to day. And here's ways that I can cut. Here's ways I can't. I can't cut. I need a roof over my head. I need to be able to travel, right? But it's looking at those aspects. Did I answer your question? Okay. Thank you very much.